Hey, everybody.
I'm Gigi.
And I'm Coconut.
We have a great lesson planned today. We have help from Sister Katie.
And Brother Andrew.
We're going to start with a fun song.
Yes, sir.
Take it away, Sister Katie.
But I'm all tuckered out.
Woo, me too.
Now it's time for our lesson. Brother Andrew's going to talk.
I think he's going to tell us something about the day of Pentecost.
And the Holy Ghost.
Hey, kids. Remember a couple weeks ago when Sister Joy talked to you about the Holy Ghost and all the cool things that it does? We're going to talk a little bit more about that today, but we're going to focus on the power that comes with the Holy Ghost. Are you ready? It's going to be great.
All right, so we're going to start today by talking about, I said we're going to talk about the power of the Holy Ghost. First, we're going to talk about the things that came before the power of the Holy Ghost came. You see, all the disciples, they had seen all that Jesus had done. And they had been with him and walked with him and seen his ministry. And Jesus had told them that he was going to go to heaven and that he was going to prepare a place for them and he was going to send them a comforter. Now I just poured some milk in here. Let's just get our base here. So that was the foundation that Jesus laid. All the things that he did while he was here on earth is just the foundation that he laid. He showed us the foundation of what our potential was. In John chapter 14 and verse 12, it talks about Jesus, when he told his disciples, he said, the things that I did on earth, you will do also, and greater things than these shall you do, because I go to my Father. So all the things that he did on earth was just the foundation that he laid. And then the disciples had to build on that foundation. So later on we see all the things that the disciples had. So let's talk about that. The disciples, they had faith because it took faith to believe the things that Jesus had said. Let's add a little food coloring here. It took faith for them to believe the things that Jesus had said because they had no proof of what was going to happen after Jesus left. But they had faith because of things that they had seen Jesus do and because of things that they knew about Jesus. So then also they had hope. They had hope that Jesus would send them the Comforter. They had love because Jesus told them that by their love, people would know that they were his disciples. And they had each other. They had unity. They had fellow believers. The disciples all gathered together, the Bible says, in the upper room. So they had each other. We need each other. In all the different times and all the different things that we face, we need each other. But you see how all this stuff is, it's kind of all separated and there's really nothing going on very much. You see how all the things that I put in here, they just kind of stay in their own little spot? Well, what they needed the Comforter, the Holy Ghost, the power that Jesus had said. He said, stay in Jerusalem until you be endued with power from on high. That power was the Holy Ghost. And when the Holy Ghost was poured out, it said it set upon each of them. And they began to speak with other tongues. The Spirit gave them utterance. It talks about it being like a fire shut up in their bones. And when I think of fire, I get excited. Fire is exciting. It's hot and it's active. And I don't know about you guys, but I love fireworks. Fireworks are beautiful and they're explosive. They're loud. They're amazing to watch. And that's kind of what this is. When the Holy Ghost comes in, so this detergent is going to be the Holy Ghost. Look at that. The Holy Ghost comes in and everything just kind of boom, explodes and starts mixing all together. And then it gets over here and it goes that way. Oh man, look at that. It's fireworks in my bowl here. See all that? The Holy Ghost comes in and the power of the Holy Ghost causes everything to explode and to mix. And it blends all the things together. All the things that we already had, all the ingredients that the disciples already had. They had the foundation, they had the love, they had the hope, they had the faith. But they needed that Holy Ghost. And when that Holy Ghost came on the scene, it did things that they weren't able to do by themselves. And it sent them out throughout all the world. The Bible talks about Jesus telling them to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And that didn't happen until the Holy Ghost came. You see, some of these spots here that I've put it in, some of the spots I just recently put it in are still moving. You see this part over here, it's kind of stagnant. It's not moving anymore. So every now and then you have to get another dose of the Holy Ghost. Every now and then you have to get some more of it to get you moving again. Sometimes in our lives we stop, we forget what's going on, and we forget what we're supposed to be doing, and we forget that this Holy Ghost is in us, and we have to stir it up, like the Bible says, to stir up that gift that is within us by way of remembrance. So I got to remember that that Holy Ghost, that power, is supposed to stay active in my life. And if I keep adding and keep going, it'll keep growing and keep exploding and keep burning. Now, this is just a fun little experiment that you can do with your parents' permission. It's just milk and food coloring and dish detergent. But I hope that you understood what I was saying. I hope that you understand what we're talking about. That just as all this stuff is going everywhere and it's spreading out, and that dish detergent made all the colors explode like fireworks, that's exactly what the Holy Ghost is going to do in our lives. When we receive it, it's going to take all the things that is inside of us and make it magnify, and it's going to throw out all the bad, and it's going to expand all the good things, all that love and hope and faith that we have inside of us. That experience that we've had with Jesus. You know, the disciples, they had experiences with Jesus before. They had walked with him and talked with him and eaten with him, spent time with him, but they hadn't had that power. They didn't know what the Holy Ghost felt like. And so all that experience, you can have an experience with Jesus, but until you receive the Holy Ghost, you're not going to get the full experience. You're not going to get the full effect of the power that Jesus has to offer. I hope that you guys understand, and I hope that you're all actively asking Jesus for the Holy Ghost. It's a free gift that he gives to each and every one that asks of him. Just as it says in Acts chapter 2 and verse 38, it says, and Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of your sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. It's a promise. It's a promise that is for everybody. If you repent of your sins You ask Jesus for your forgiveness of your sins, and you promise that you're going to move away from them, and then you're baptized in the name of Jesus. This is the promise that you have, that you will receive the Holy Ghost. Love you guys. Hope to see you soon.
That was a great lesson about the Holy Ghost, Brother Andrew.
Yeah, it was awesome. The Holy Ghost is so powerful.
Man, I feel like I have all the power in the world.
I feel like I got a river in my belly.
Oh, Sister Katie's going to sing about a river?
What? Take it away, Sister Katie.
The first case we discussed, I met a lady named Mary who was looking for her friend Jesus. He had been killed and his body stolen, but we found him alive and well, and he sent us to his disciples to share the news. Well, after that, things got even more interesting. Jesus came and went a few times, giving further instructions to his disciples of what they should do when he was gone. This all culminated one day when we all watched as he ascended into heaven, never to walk the earth as a man again. One of the things he said before he left was that the disciples should wait at Jerusalem until the power came to them. They were gracious enough to allow me to stay with them, but I grew restless in the little upper room they had gathered in. Jesus had promised power, and I intended to find it. I left the house and began my investigation. I didn't know a lot about the prophecies surrounding Jesus, but I had heard people refer to him as the Son of David, after the great king of old. So I thought that was a good place to start. Of course, King Herod was no David, but power is power, and I figured the king would have more power than anyone else in the kingdom. I thought maybe Herod was the one bringing the power from Jesus. It didn't take me long to realize just how terribly wrong I was. I called my contact in the JPD, and he told me that not only were Herod and Jesus not friends, but that Herod had been the one who sent Jesus to Pilate, who had Jesus killed. So much for that plan. My next thought was that maybe the power would come from the religious leaders. After all, Jesus was supposed to be God, right? It would make sense that the Pharisees would hold the key to his power. Boy, was I wrong. When I went to the temple and started asking about Jesus, I barely made it out alive. Those Pharisees must have chased me for 6 city blocks, yelling about stoning me for blasphemy. At this point, I was very confused. Jesus had promised power, but it didn't look like anybody in power wanted anything to do with him. I decided to go back where the disciples had gathered and see if maybe there was more that Jesus had said that I hadn't heard. When I got close to the house, I saw a large crowd gathered. There were people from all different countries. They were all very excited about something.
but I didn't understand what they were saying. Finally, I heard someone speaking my language. He was saying something about people being drunk too early in the morning and speaking languages they couldn't have known. It didn't make any sense to me, but then I looked up and saw Peter, one of the disciples, motioning for everyone to quiet down. He started talking about a guy named Joel and how what was happening was part of a prophecy. He said that nobody was drunk, but that this was the Spirit of God. Then he started preaching about Jesus. He told them about how Jesus came to earth and did miracles, about how he died and rose again. He told them that Jesus had promised the Holy Ghost would come down, and this was it. Oh man, I had missed it. The power had come and I wasn't here to see it. A man next to me yelled out to Peter and the apostles, asking what he should do. We all waited to hear the response. Then Peter said unto them, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of your sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost." I had had it all wrong. The power wasn't in royalty or religion. The power was in obedience and faith. There were around 3,000 that day that received the power. I'm thankful to say that I was one of them, and I'll never be the same.
That Fluffy sure is funny.
He's awesome. Hey kids, we're gonna have one more song.
Sister Katie is gonna sing about making our heart a home for Jesus.
Go ahead and stand up and worship together as we sing. And he made my heart his home.
Me too.
Hey kids, thanks so much for worshiping with us. We hope to see you soon.
As always, remember the craft at the end of this video. You might need your parents' help, but if you don't, remember to ask for permission.
We love you!